My name is CJ Adams, and I'm a product manager at Jigsaw. Jigsaw is an incubator at Alphabet, and our goal is to try and understand the needs of people who are facing threats to their free expression, who are facing oppression in their ability to express their ideas, and trying to connect those needs to technology that might exist at Google or elsewhere that could help. And this is our logo. One of the emerging areas of interest for us is online conversations. So when we think about civility, we were thinking about it in the workplace, but it's also an enormous problem online. When we think about the internet and the sort of dream of the internet, it's supposed to be something like this. We dream it's like this. Anyone can set up a conversation on an email thread or in a comment stream or in their own forum and attract diverse ideas from all around the world and take part in this discussion with ideas you agree with and disagree with, but having a learning from all around the world at the same time. But unfortunately, a lot of conversations look a lot more like this. You've got a couple people who can jump into the conversation and just take it over and shout and yell and force other ideas out of the room. You can actually silence people by simply being so loud and rude that no one even wants to engage in the discussion. Now, you might have experienced this in a workplace. If you send out something on an email thread, it just gets taken over by a couple people who are shouting, and everyone else is sort of left on the side just watching. Or if you scroll through comments, they seem so vitriolic, but you don't even want to engage because it's not even worth your time. And maybe if someone does jump in and say, you know what, I'm going to stand up for this. I believe against this idea that's being shouted and yelled, that person is often the subject of a targeted attack. Not just on their idea, but actually on the person themselves. In the most extreme cases, this can actually be an organized campaign of harassment on an individual person, threatening their own safety in the real world. Or we've seen cases where Russian troll farms will be paid to target an idea or target people that are saying things that the person paying for this mob disagrees with. So we end up back here. And people just give up on conversations online. They think, this can't be civil. We can't have open, enriching discussions about controversial topics. But what if we wanted to? What if we didn't want to give up on this? What might we do? How could we make open, enriching discussions online a reality? Well, let's first take a look at some of the standard practices people use. So these are the kind of three methods that are often applied to online conversations. You've got kind of the platform rules. The problem here is, who defines those rules? Who makes them? They might work for extreme cases, but what about all the sort of subtle tones and rules? Who's going to make those? How are you going to enforce them? There's also real names policies, where you say, well, maybe people won't be quite as mean if their real name is attached to it. But we found that this often silences people's opinions when they want to share something that is particularly vulnerable. People who want to make a point but don't want that tied to their name. And so you end up silencing some of the same marginalized voices that you were trying to protect in the first place. And then there's flagging. And flagging is one of the best tools we've got so far. And that's where everyone can kind of say, hey, I'm going to flag this as being bad. But one of the problems there is not everyone takes part in flagging. And what do you do once it's flagged? So each method that exists right now has its shortcomings, and it leads us to the situation where people are giving up. But there's some emerging research and some new applications of ways of cultivating online communities and conversations, which have been quite promising and exciting. And that's the combination of community feedback with machine learning. So let's talk about what we mean by each of these things. So community feedback is every bit of feedback that you get from your peers. If someone's cell phone was to go off in the audience right now, people kind of look at you and you'd quickly scramble for your phone and turn it off. And that's your peers telling you, I'm in a space where I don't want a phone to be ringing right now. You know, it's the little signals that would tell you that it's probably okay in this context to jump up and down and scream, and not so much in this context. There's no rules on the doors of these places when you walk in, but it's our peers giving us information about what kind of conversation and community and space they want to be in. But this doesn't exist online. We just have this text box and we throw it over the transom without any feedback about how that's emotionally impacting the people that are reading it. And you know, there are some small examples. You know, if Bob sends an email to 1,000 people and it's quite rude, and you're friends with Bob and you send Bob a little note saying, hey, maybe you want to rephrase that or send out another note, that's a small bit of digital community feedback. But it takes a ton of work, constant manual labor nudging the community in the direction. And it's really, really hard to scale. So that's where machine learning can come in. So machine learning is just the process of training a computer to do a task and train it to learn to do this task, as opposed to programming it to do something specific. So an example is if we wanted to train a computer to find out which of these photos were dogs and which were cats, we could program it and say, look for two eyes or four legs or kind of bigger, or four legs or bigger ears. But it's really hard because you don't know what the photo is going to be like. So with machine learning, what we can do is we can add tags where we can feed a machine hundreds of thousands of images of dogs and cats, and slowly the machine starts figuring out features of this so that it can learn what a dog looks like and what a cat looks like. And this works in the real world. This is my dog, and I was able to pull up these photos in Google Photos by typing in dog. Now, I never tagged that these were dogs, but the machine learning models are able to learn what a dog looks like and find my dog, Lou. And this is my dog wearing a mouse costume on the top left there. But let's stop for a second, because cats are always cats, dogs are always dogs. There isn't always a clear definition of what is an enriching conversation. And that's different for each community and each context. So how do you let these kind of scaled rules be formed by a community for a community? Well, one of the coolest applications of this that's existed so far has been done by Riot Games. And I'd encourage you to read their Nature paper that just came out. But they've combined these two things in a really powerful way. If you're not familiar with Riot Games, they make League of Legends, which is a massive online multiplayer game where you compete with other people and coordinate to fight your opponent. And the coordination is the game. The community that exists in there is the game. And how you coordinate with your friends is by chatting in the messages. But they were finding a lot of people would leave the game because they were feeling threatened or harassed in the game. If you look down the left-hand corner, there's some salty language down here. And if this was your first time playing, you might leave the game because you didn't like it. But they didn't know what rules to program, so they started letting the users define what they wanted, what kind of community and space they wanted. And they created something called a tribunal, where anytime a game was flagged as being abusive, they would raise a case and give incentives so you had millions of gamers all voting on what was an okay game or what was a bad one. And that feedback of just saying the community said you broke this rule led to a situation where 50% of people stopped exhibiting that behavior in the future. Then they started sending them the entire case, saying it's not just that you broke the obscenity rule, but this is the exact line that the community said wasn't okay. And that bumped them up to 70% of people stopped exhibiting that behavior in the future. But it was really hard to scale and get that fast feedback. And that's where machine learning came in, where they were able to actually build models, like we did with the dogs and the cats, build models on what the community thought was and wasn't okay, and give immediate feedback. And that got them up to 92% of people stopping exhibiting this type of abusive behavior in the games going forward. There's also examples, Yik Yak, for example, was able to train data on what users reported as being threatening. And they now pause people when they're typing something that's triggered by that ML model, saying like, hold on, pump the brakes, I bet you're a great person, but this looks kind of like things that other people have said are threatening. And this is just the beginning. At Google, we've recently open sourced a library called TensorFlow, which lets anyone create machine learning models of their own. And we're looking to engage with research with other communities who want to connect the power of community feedback and these feedback loops with machine learning to scale open discussions online where enriching ideas can be shared with diverse perspectives in the tone that the community chooses. Thanks so much.